All right, looks like we're live. I'm here with Michael Frasinelli. He's basically our lead tokenomics expert for Noland. He's been working quite a bit on details that have gone back and forth for the tokenomics, and he's hopefully here to answer some of the questions that the community has had. Thanks for being here, Michael.
Yeah, no, definitely. I'm happy to be here.
Awesome, yeah. So, before we kind of dive into it, I kind of wanted to start on a little bit on your background, like where are you coming from?
As Johnny said, I'm Michael Frasinelli. I've been leading up tokenomics for the Gnoland project and kind of related all in bits projects that are connected to it. Are connected to other development efforts here for the better part of 8 months. My background has been in quantitative modeling and simulation, kind of stretching back. That was kind of the bedrock of everything. From there, I transitioned more into traditional finance, things like portfolio optimization. People would give me 50 assets of a whole bunch of different asset classes, and hey, we want at least this reward, but we can't go above this level of risk. But the last 7 or 8 years have been pretty much strictly blockchain here. So, lots of bouncing between different firms or, anything from investment to VC to ETF, either helping them research new projects or often brought in to help set up the sustainability and just kind of long-term goals of a project in terms of its tokenomics and its system design and just overall sustainability. Most recently, I helped found a project called Theopetra Labs, which is a real-world asset project. That's actually where Gnoland ended up reaching out to me. All in Bits ended up reaching out to me, pulling me from there. But so they're essentially bringing real estate on chain and decentralizing it, similar to a lot of things in our industry. Through that process, they kind of have a placeholder tokenomic system, but they're in the process of transferring something in the neighborhood of a 250,000 square foot of property that they've been able to acquire since their founding. And they're starting to move that value on chain and doing some cool stuff with oracles with Chainlink. And through part of that process, we would run studies for the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development and local housing authorities to try to essentially use the efficiencies that blockchain and smart contracts bring to basically make every dollar spent on affordable housing or on government programs, things of that nature, go further to try to help the affordable housing issues that are definitely present in America as well as plenty other parts of the world.
That's cool. It's actually sort of, one of the big legitimate use cases for crypto there.
Yeah, and it's like for me, it was so fascinating because before that, it was very rare to actually have a blockchain project that had like revenue in a traditional sense, and operations in a traditional sense. And it was a lot of fun, and it's kind of even carried with me in an aspect of trying to get that value kind of captured within the chain. I mean, it comes with some extra structuring hurdles, things of that nature, to make sure everything is being done as well as it can possibly be, and in a way that doesn't upset any of the different bodies out there. But yeah, just being able to kind of merge the real physical world with a lot of the decentralization aspects and a lot of the kind of middlemen being cut out, like everything from escrow to there's so many different parts of real estate that don't necessarily, they're kind of a byproduct of not having trustless systems. And when you start introducing those trustless systems, the things that we have for so long relied on, Ron the broker or whatever, it's like it's kind of amazing the amount of gains you can see from that. Like for example, the HUD study that I mentioned, the housing study that I mentioned, it was found that just with relatively straightforward efficiency tweaks, the Department of Housing and Urban Development could save something like 40% of their federal budget per year. So it's like the cap of some of this stuff is incredible, and we're not quite in the like the original throw absolutely everything on a blockchain and see what sticks things, but the things that it does do, It does extremely well, especially with kind of the advent of smart contracts and a lot of the more recent developments that have made those more secure and more complex as a whole.
Okay. With that background, I mean, do you feel like that has kind of helped with your transition to working for Noland?
Yeah, definitely. So I at that point, I was very much kind of Spartan trained from building things from the ground up. And, you know, from there's so many aspects that you don't even think of until you're actually, you know, things that aren't even necessarily connecting to the engineering aspect or whatever that tie in to kind of create the synergy between the company as a whole. But in this case, a lot of the things that I've been doing for GnoLand kind of directly tie in. I've been setting the basic incentive structures and governance structures for what will end up being GnoLand. Of course, working closely with Manfred and Jay, who've been working with me and signing off on some of the things we've been putting together, assisting the finance team a little bit in that aspect, just in terms of looking at long-term horizons. Revamping the Game of Realms competition we're running to incentivize early contributors to start learning our new language, GNO. And then the ever asked about airdrop simulations and essentially everything else that's in the ballpark of modeling or simulation, in addition to the more game theory tokenomic kind of systems. And that's kind of very much carried with me even before I got into tokenomics, when it was more traditional aspects. And you know, at this point, I can't quite see myself going back in the opposite way, but enough of that is kind of carried that there's been that common theme kind of throughout my entire career, and I'm happy to get to use it here.
That's cool. Yeah. So, I mean, you went directly from this crypto real estate project to Noland. So did you have any background in Cosmos?
Cosmos particularly, not all that much, which, doesn't necessarily seem like something that is the worst thing in the world nowadays, in terms of just getting some fresh eyes in on everything. And you know, I'm not as much of a, I mean, I feel like you're as much of a Cosmos historian as anyone I've ever met, so you could comment a whole lot more. But Cosmos in particular, I've always kept an eye on over the years. I've always been fascinated with the idea of an L0 of multiple Bitcoin or multiple blockchains kind of working in tandem. For me, more of my effort in that ballpark went towards Polkadot and that related ecosystem, as well as some other things like the Stax blockchain and that allowing smart contracts to be built on top of Bitcoin, standard Ethereum stuff, things of that nature. But this is my first time actually working on a full-fledged Cosmos project that's been anything besides me helping with the very initial design stage.
Okay. You mentioned that AIB reached out to you. How did you find out about Noland? Was it that moment or was it before that?
Yeah, so it was that moment. So I ended up having a recruiter reach out to me that then connected us to the internal recruiters at the company, who were all great. And, pretty lengthy vetting process. I joke that in the past I was able to get certified for like top secret clearance stuff in about as much time. But coming onto the team, it's very much apparent that it sets the bar kind of where I really like to see it a lot of the time. I mean, like it's I can't stress enough the skill level of a lot of the people that we're working with here. And that's been the main thing that's hit me. And I feel like a lot of that is that initial vetting process where, you know, I ended up having the recruitment reach out to me and I was able to watch all of Manfred and Jay's presentations on the project and kind of slowly work through everything that had been done thus far. And then just went through that whole process and believe it was May that I started here officially.
Okay. I mean, so they reached out to you, and then you kind of got a gist of the project. You did your background research. What was your main motivator? Like what brought you here?
Yeah. To me, the really core concept that still excites me even now is the concept of creating essentially a fully autonomous meritocracy, where opposed to the amount of tokens that you have staked or the amount of infrastructure you built up, which, hey, like, I used to love validator nodes and L7 Litecoin miners and the whole nine, but it's like to fully remove that aspect of it from governance and from building an ecosystem and base it strictly on how much somebody contributes to the overarching goals. That to me is really fascinating and something that I feel like hasn't been attempted, at least in this industry, to quite the same level before. So that's always what I come back to in terms of design as really the pillar of this. I also love the aspect of, you know, we're building everything. We're building an entire ecosystem. It's not just me launching a token. It's not even me just helping to design a chain. It's creating a new smart contract language, creating new infrastructure, creating new chains on top of that, and all of the associated dApps and things of that nature. A lot of the times when you're working on a token or even a chain, you hit a roadblock, and that roadblock, in the case of a token, is the chain itself, some feature that's hard coded in or that's baked in, or even when you're building a chain, just a lot of times, you know, just the resource restrictions, things of that nature that force you to do things a certain way, or the language itself, the smart contract language, or VM language. And in this case, basically, we're able to work in tandem on all of that at the same time, which does lead to a longer development cycle. But it allows me, hey, I hit this roadblock, we simulated it, this thing popped up, that's a result of this. We can directly go to that part of the system, whether it's the chain or the VM or the language, and actually adjust that to not just make development more straightforward and more precise, but to hopefully make this as powerful and as frictionless of a system and just overall language to use as possible whenever it does eventually launch here.
Cool. So just so people know, like, you're actually one of the main dudes behind this airdrop, right? You mentioned before you're running simulations, you're kind of figuring out a restructuring of the Game of Realms competition. Do you want to like fill us in a little bit more about what you got going on at Noland?
Yeah, definitely.
Like, what's your day-to-day look like? What kind of work are you working on?
Right. A big part of what I do like about the job is just due to the nature of how many things eventually need some kind of quantitative element to test them or go over them or different design elements, or hey, is there a way that somebody could break this? I do, you know, my standard team is the engineering team. So through them, I'm largely with Manfred leading the effort in terms of the overall design of GnoLand, overall design of the DAOs, the testing of all of that, reward testing, governance testing, long-term sustainability. But then as well as other, you know, grantee projects, people that submit through our grant program, I'm able to do analysis there. Anything related to research or anything in that ballpark, Python, SQL, things of that nature, I'm able to assist with. And then more recently, I'm, you know, at least going to do my best here to be a little bit more of a direct feed between marketing and engineering to help answer some of these questions that seem to have existed long before my role has, that hopefully we can at least clear up some of the big ones here today. And then moving forward, I'm always happy to answer anything I can. Anything I can answer, I'm at least happy to tell you what we're working on and what we're bouncing around and what things could look like, even if we don't know exactly what they'll look like.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, just having a little bit of transparency as to like what's happening behind the curtain, I think would be helpful. A lot of people are, you know, a lot of people are really concerned that the project has been taking a while. But before we touch on that, like, I know you have some demonstrations for us and some other stuff you want to talk about, but I'm kind of curious, like, you know, you moved from this crypto real estate project and then you kind of dove headfirst in the Noland. It's kind of a process, right? Like, what was your transition like from your previous programming environment into Noland? How did that go? Did it take a bit?
Yeah, definitely a bit of an onboarding process, largely in the sense of, like you said, I mean, I think the airdrop was probably announced at least a full year before I came on board. So it's like a lot of these aspects were pre-existing when I got here, and there had already been a lot of design iterations that had been went through. Some was just high level things that the team knew they wanted. Some of it was more defined ideas, some of which stayed, some of which hasn't. So a big part of that process initially was coming on, and I watched every single, which thankfully through being a largely open source, more open source than I've seen outside of a nonprofit, outside of a very, very particular situations, it's like all of our old meetings were recorded. So I was able to go through and rewatch all the old meetings that were related to anything similar and talk to a lot of the engineers, talk to Manfred, talk to Jay, and spend a lot of time just getting on the same page as them and hopefully syncing up in terms of the high-level goals and core ideas in the time frame in which we're trying to do that. And the core ideas, and I think the overarching theme has largely stayed the same, though. From there, a lot of systems were kind of reworked from the ground up. There's, you know, probably issues from years ago on GitHub that have been changed since, and we're starting to have more documentation released that goes over all of those changes and specifics. But I think we've done a really good job of fine-tuning anything that needed it while leaving in the bigger core aspects that really kind of, again, enticed me in the first place. The meritocracy aspects, the censorship-resistant aspects, the extreme transparency of everything. Since, again, the fact that we're basically taking Google's open source language, Golang, and we're porting that, creating our own interpreted version of it that's more specifically for blockchain and comes with a bunch of additional features for that. You know, in that case, it's the kind of thing where it's like, again, everything kind of ties together in that ballpark. And, you know, you can essentially use the tools of the language to then create tools that allow for a better chain. So just kind of the blend between all of that together. But
you were mentioning a bit about the transparency of our company. Like, I feel like there's not a lot of people that know that you can very much follow the progress of Noland through the GitHub repo, like even to the point that the internal meetings that we have on tokenomics are put on there. Like you've made a point to start copying those onto the GitHub, right?
Yeah. So I do have, and we can even share it wherever we post this here. I do have like a central issue where we put all of the weekly, bi-weekly tokenomics meetings. They did just get recently moved to weekly, but they were bi-weekly leading up to now. And then, yeah, thanks for reminding me. I had missed that point when I was talking on the last question. I mean, even transparency, not just in releasing all of our meeting notes and our meeting recordings and things of that nature, but even the language itself is being designed to be as transparent as possible. Where something like Solidity, when you run a smart contract on Solidity on Ethereum with MetaMask or whatever, you can't really, even if you know the language, can't really look at it top to bottom. And after it's executed, like it gets turned into bytecode, or there's all these other processes that could be happening, essentially makes it very hard to audit. Where in our case, it starts in the same language that it ends in. Somebody that knows that language is able to fully and transparently not just watch all of the content, not just watch our internal meetings or see all of our PRs being completed, which granted our GitHub is giant because of the amount of different projects being worked on. So it is difficult to follow sometimes, which is why I'm trying to create more summary documents. But even the language itself is created to be as transparent as possible in terms of an auditing perspective where you don't even, I mean, of course there will exist dedicated auditors, but someone doesn't even necessarily need to be to audit the contract. I think that'll make it easier for them third-party tools that similar to what we've started to see in other chains that kind of spit out security summaries for you before you execute a contract. Stuff like that is kind of baked in from the very beginning with us instead of something that's added a decade after launch, like we've seen in some cases.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely an advantage to a developer that hops onto this ecosystem. One thing that's actually really interesting about that is that Noland is kind of, you know, it is taking a while, but like once this product is out and available, it's going to have a tool set that's like really functional, really adaptable, really modular. Like I know the Birdie team has been working on making like the framework global accessible. Like we have OnBlocks that's been contributing quite a bit. Like I think it's a little bit understated how much the functionality of this project is going to like expedite the process of development once it kind of gains that traction.
And that's the whole thing too. Like back to the whole like, you know, in terms of the airdrop and things of that nature, it's like the airdrop's the easy part. You know, the token is even, in a sense, the easy part in comparison to a lot of this other stuff that's going on behind the scenes, where it's not even just necessarily a chain being released, it's a full ecosystem. Like you said, it's like not only are we working on the core aspects, including eventually a new version of Tendermint, new version of tons of different protocols, just as part of the core thing, and the new language, and the new VM, and the new validator system, etc. But then we have Birdie, who's already working on an iOS and Android mobile development framework in terms of building with GNO. We already have our own, you know, IDE, so that more specific in terms of writing smart contracts versus like a Go land that you would write standard Go in, wallets and explorers and, you know, DEXs, and between the grantees and the core team, this is truly a full ecosystem being built in tandem and kind of in collaboration, in the sense we're making sure that everything is being built in a way that makes it as straightforward as everyone else, or as needed for everyone else to do their job as best as they can possibly do it. And as a result, yeah, it's taking quite a while, and it will probably take a while more, but I feel like the aspects that a lot of people are asking about are probably the aspects that are already done. And we might even go into that a little bit later in this call here to show kind of what some of that might look like and some of the early stages. And, you know, again, I'm happy to summarize any of the other systems we're currently working on as well.
Yeah, let's touch on that. Let's start talking about tokenomics. Like first off, I kind of want to ask you, what do you find the most fulfilling or challenging when working on the NoLand tokenomics?
Yeah, so I'll go in order there. In terms of fulfilling, again, well, in a sense, the first point is kind of both in the fulfilling and challenging category, just going back to that extreme customization between building an entire ecosystem at once from scratch. A lot of times, I mean, the amount of decisions that are able to be made, the amount of options, the amount of different variants that you can create of all these different systems, probably dozens of interlocking systems, that can, in circumstances, lead to decision paralysis, in the sense where we have so many things we could do. What do we do? And that's, you know, a lot of the times, hopefully, where my job comes in, where we can quantify some of that stuff and continue to talk through it and debate it and things of that nature. I feel like with the way things have been organized, we're able to get around a good portion of that, but it does take a lot of communication, a lot of meetings, a lot of kind of working groups, in a sense, kind of sub-assigning tasks. But then at the same time, that's one of the most fulfilling aspects, is that it truly is kind of a 0 to 100, 360 building of everything needed to make this, you know, a chain that I would ideally want to use just as a user perspective. The other part that is, you know, it's also kind of challenging in the sense, like, you know, we've talked about a little bit here, there are some existing systems. So not even necessarily changing those existing systems, but then communicating those changes and, you know, hey, this is all the same, but then there's this little tweak here, or hey, this is all the same, but we changed the name of this thing, so it's less confusing, and here's why we did it. So a lot of those kind of play back and forth on each other, but, and, you know, so I'd say the bulk of the challenges revolve around that. It's just the sheer scale of what we're working on and all of the moving pieces that are part of it. And then, but back to the kind of fulfilling side of that, thankfully we do have genuinely one of the most talented teams that I've ever worked with in the 7-8 years I've been strictly working on blockchain, and longer than that, just kind of in this general ballpark, and genuinely some of the best programmers that I've ever even seen, let alone met. So I do feel like everything is in good hands, largely, as thanks to that, and it's just a matter of continuing to finish one aspect at a time, language, VM, etc., and working our way to the finish line here.
Yeah, we're getting close.
Closer, yeah.
I kind of wanted to touch on that. Like, a lot of people, you know, I mean, I get it almost every day. When airdrop? A lot of people are concerned the project is taking so long. You know, what's going on behind the scenes? When is this expected to hit mainnet? Like, I was kind of wondering, do you have any sort of insight on what's happening there?
Yeah, I'm not sure in terms of being able to give definitive answers at this point, unfortunately. I know that's not fun to hear. But in a sense, you know, it's like we are trying to launch with X amount of features. Like if we could rush and release something that basically does nothing, you know, that doesn't have the basic dApp support that we want or the basic language functions that we want to truly build the ecosystem that we're envisioning here. But you know, so that is kind of the first benchmark where there will likely be sooner rather than later. It's a matter of months, ideally definitely less than a year, but somewhere in that ballpark, at least a preliminary launch where we could at least get the tokens airdropped. They might start as non-transferable or limited in function and strictly kind of like an early access. Beyond testnet, I mean, we're on testnet 4 or something at this point. We're well into that. But when it comes to the actual launch, like just allowing the community that is not a formal grantee or a formal contributor, allowing them to start building their own applications, their own packages, their own tooling, just by using the token to pay gas, essentially, that'll come sooner than later. And then after that point, a lot of the other promised core features will be rolling out in the following months, very soon after that. You know, of course, first making it transferable and then adding different protocols to it and different features, things of that nature. So it will be a gradual process. And now that I do feel like we do have a very solid grasp on the design on a higher level, and any discussion is largely revolving around extremely nitpicky details, or do we have this parameter, is this number, and ultimately we'll all be able to be voted on by our governance DAO when we launch anyways, at least a lot of it. You know, we're definitely, it's kind of all hands on deck to at least get that initial building version done where we can airdrop, we can let you guys start building. When exactly it'll be, I'm not sure, but it is the plan step that is like priority one for the entire engineering team in terms of that is our next milestone.
Cool. Great to hear. I'm hoping other people are happy to hear that too. We talked a little bit earlier about how you have some demonstrations of some of the simulations, or maybe some airdrop info. Did you want to potentially screen share some of that?
Yeah, we can go over some stuff here just to kind of show where things currently stand. So we did start simulating the airdrop already. There's a couple different small tweaks that might happen here or there. But as a whole, again, in a sense, the aspects like this are on the easier end in comparison to the ecosystem as a whole. But I've, of course, hit addresses here, and this is, of course, not necessarily 100% final. But just showing a basic idea of what things may look like. And of course, we have more options down along the bottom. But this is kind of how I'll approach it to ensure a certain level of decentralization is hit and that everything is functioning properly well beforehand. So essentially what I did is I created a Python script that aggregated all of the Atom holdings from the snapshot we took exactly one a year or two ago. And then from that point, it took how everybody voted on proposal 69 for Cosmos, right. And then it weighted their Atom holdings based on how they vote. So you can kind of view it in a sense where everybody starts as their base value of Gnot, our gas token that you would receive through this airdrop. It would match the percentage of Atom that you had at the time of the snapshot. So if you had 0.1% supply of the Atom airdrop, then you would have 0.1% supply of Gnot whenever that releases. From there, it is further weighted and adjusted based off of how people voted, which is this column here. And as you can see, by far the rule opposed to the exception is people abstaining. So of course we want people that have abstained for one of dozens of reasons, you know, didn't see the vote, haven't been involved in the ecosystem in a while, etc., they'll still be receiving an airdrop. They'll be receiving likely a 0.7 or 0.8 times multiplier against their base atom value. So, you know, if you had, you know, just for easier percentages, let's say you have 10% of the atom supply, you're like the biggest whale in the world, apparently. And if you abstain from voting on Prop 69, then you'd receive, you know, 0.7 or, you know, 7-8% of the total GNOT supply instead of that 10% you started with. Similarly, if somebody voted yes at this time, it is planned to slash that amount, which would be feeding back to the rest of the airdrop. And from there, of course, moving into no, which would be a slight bonus, maybe a 10% bonus versus your starting atom supply, and no with veto on the highest end, but somewhere in the ballpark of a 1.3 multiplier, increasing it. And then from there, so for example, this person voted no with veto, giving them the very highest multiplier. So even though they only had 300,000 atom at the time of the snapshot, they are surpassing, in terms of a percentage of the airdrop they are receiving, even people with, you know, in the neighborhood of 500,000 atom that sustained here. So it has a massive impact whenever it does have an impact here. This 25% is a theoretical allocation that would be potentially going towards, you know, the project as a whole. But for the bulk of everything else, there's, you know, not planned to be too much craziness in terms of distribution besides the airdrop itself. You know, looking into things of what would the top whale be under different systems, which again, this one isn't necessarily final, but okay, it's in the ballpark of 6%. Are we okay with that? Are we not okay with that? If we're not okay with it, is it fair to not be okay with it? Like, what is leading to this condition? We can basically, what I kind of have to do at this point too, is making sure that we're going back and forth regarding this, but making sure that the way a validator voted or didn't vote, carries to the people that delegated with them and impacts their airdrop as well. That'll most likely be the case, but that's still up in the air as well. We're viewing simulations both ways, have it set up so that we can very easily tweak those multipliers by a little bit. That's what I told you should be more or less accurate in terms of how we'll be adjusting based off of the base atom, atom snapshot. But, if there are any small adjustments, they'll be exactly that, small adjustments and refinements, and, essentially making sure that everything, ran properly before we actually do the airdrop itself. But, so yeah, this aspect is one of the earlier things I actually completed when I did come on board. So we've been sitting on stuff like this for a little bit. Now it's getting to the point where we actually feel like we're giving you something that's worth airdropping. We're giving you something you're able to do with it, and you're able to build with it, and you're able to participate in a wider ecosystem and start coding with us and start, you know, anything. Because that's the thing as well. When I say that this network is going to be governed by people that contribute towards the project and the overarching high level goals of it, you don't have to be a programmer necessarily. You can make YouTube videos or do, you know, write articles every now or then or teach people how it works. Or, you know, we want contribution in like the literal sense, where it's not a necessarily just GitHub code contribution, but contribution. And I think anyone that's worked for a company that's large enough to have departments or multiple teams, it's really the sum of everything that makes a project successful, or that makes a project coherent and streamlined. You know, and again, that's what I would like to assist with in terms of helping feed information from engineering and talking to John here or anyone else that's interested in bouncing ideas around or discussing on GitHub or just asking questions. So stuff like this, we're going to keep working on. Of course, you know, we'll be simulating things like the how gas and fees are going to work, different Game of Realms competition systems, scoring for that, how that's all involved. That'll have a new, some pretty big updates relatively soon as well. The Game of Realms competition that'll eventually lead to the earliest DAO members, in terms of this as a whole. But yeah, day to day, things can change a lot. It can be something like this. It can be, can be more theoretical, or it could be just straight up math opposed to code. So really depends on the priority at the exact time. And at this exact time, the priorities are A, revamping Game of Realms, and B, getting us to this airdrop situation where we have as much built out for at least a preliminary building airdrop as possible here. And I guess while we're screen sharing here, let me stop and then share something else. Just going into a little bit about how we are suspecting governance to work a little bit, at least on a very, very high level. So if I go and present just this document, yeah, just a little note tab here. So essentially the core people that contribute to the DAO, people that will ultimately be governing the DAO, they'll be divided into tiers. And essentially you start as bottom tier for getting basically any contribution accepted. And then you work your way up the tier list as you become, you know, as you contribute more and as proposals are passed, and as expertise is proven, essentially expertise and a commitment to helping expand the project. And that way, similar to like how it's always been ridiculous to me that like an accredited investor in the traditional finance world, it, at least until recently they made it so you can like take tests and become an accredited investor. Before, you had to make like X amount of money and then they considered you financially savvy, but it's like that money could come from all kinds of sectors that have nothing to do with the finance industry. Similarly, in this case, opposed to having it where the people with the most tokens or the most infrastructure, the most machines, being the people at the very top of the list, this will be strictly based off of merit and contribution and alignment towards the overarching principles that I think are kind of shared industry-wide. I think this is a good distillment of a lot of the decentralization, kind of censorship-resistant things of that nature. So again, you'll basically every single person of the same tier will share the same benefits of that tier. And the reason for that is while we're able to do it in a smaller scale with a core team, with something like Game of Realms, where we're assigning exact value quantitatively or however else to exact contributions. Oh, this bug fix is worth 10 points, but that bug fix is worth 12 points. That is a deceivingly tricky question that could go down a rabbit hole for years. It kind of has. If you look in old research reports of it on like ResearchGate or something, there's been, you know, teams working on how to fairly reward both open source contribution or really just grading exact tasks in general. I mean, I know some companies have systems where it's like you need 14 points a month while you're working for us, and each task you complete is worth a certain amount. We can do that on a smaller scale with Game of Realms, but in this case, to ensure that everything is fair, it is more viewing each contributor's entire body of work versus viewing each individual contribution and quantifying it. That'll impact, of course, their overall body of work, but it'll be viewed on a more high-end level, and it'll go through a manual review process for all of what we're discussing here. So for example, tier one would have the highest amount of governance, potentially even in the ballpark of 50%, likely KYC to get to this level, verified. And then from there, basically a geometric series where it decreases by the same amount going down each tier. So theoretically, and again, this is all subject to change, feel free to discuss it with me personally or on GitHub. I'd love to hear feedback here. But say tier one, even just for easy math, has 50%. Tier two, if we use 50% as our constant, tier one would be 50% voting power. Tier two would be 25% voting power. Tier three would be 12.5% voting power, and so on and so forth. Essentially everybody of that tier level would have the same amount of voting power as everyone else at that tier level. Similarly, everybody at the same tier level will be receiving the same amount of rewards each month, more similar to a traditional salary or something like a I would call it a universal basic income, but it's earned. So it's kind of more traditional in that aspect versus something like a UBI. But where a fixed amount is given in rewards to each person of that tier, keeping within a certain amount of fees earned by the network every month. And we'll have, you know, risk management systems automated and tested and a million things before that point to ensure that what is being paid out to these different tier levels in Gnot or anything else here is sustainable and does not exceed X amount of fees per month. But a large portion of the fees that are earned by the network are planned to go towards these contributors, or just contributors in general. It's you know, essentially taking a small, like an amount that would normally go towards a validator, even more than that, and redirecting a lot of that towards these contributors, potentially even having it where, in addition to any monetization systems that the projects actually create themselves to capture value, that there will likely be at least a small kind of royalty for the builder of each smart contract. So if you create a smart contract, any gas spent as a result of using your smart contract, by default, you would receive a percentage of that gas spent. So again, this really is boiling it back down to what it's about. Meritocracy, proof of contribution, which is, again, the key of the system. The key of that system is GovDAO. GovDAO is kind of the heart of proof of contribution, where each tier will essentially be able to govern the tier below them, and it'll be a process to move up that tier list where, you know, you would hope that the people that have spent the longest working on a project and contributing it to its well-being and growth are the exact people that would want the best for the project when it comes time to actually vote on governance proposals. And that's a large part of the idea behind it.
Wow. I think you shared like quite a bit of sort of the basis of proof contribution, right? The tokenomic structure, like how this tier ranking system is sort of going to play off for people. I almost wish this was public right now so we could get like community questions, but like you said, people can just reach out to you directly if you want to talk about this stuff. It's also on GitHub, right?
Yeah, and we'll also kind of a side task in addition to some larger tasks right now is I'm trying to summarize at least a lot of things on the engineering end and on my end of things and condense it down instead of it being split over multiple GitHub documents or issues or et cetera. Getting some more summary documentation that's kind of everything covered in a more central place. It's a little bit easier to find. I know even when I kind of moved from just the math aspects and economics aspects itself to programming, even when I was like new in programming, or even when I wasn't necessarily, it's like I didn't always want to go on GitHub to read something. Like there's, you know, I whether it's for organizational reasons or whatever else. So I think having at least the option of viewing it in other places, just for ease of searchability, things of that nature, will be important moving forward here. So I will be, a lot of them already exist, just going through final changes, but tweaking to the documents that'll kind of go over this top to bottom, at least as we have it right now. And anything where I'm not able to give a definitive, this is how we are doing it, I'm always at least happy to say, okay, well, we're, as of right now, considering this system, we're considering this system, and here's the pros and cons of each, and feel free to chime in. So anywhere where we aren't able to give definitive answers, I will at least do my best to give a rough idea of where we're at with everything and what we're working on, and take feedback as part of that. That will definitely weigh against everything else here.
Cool. Yeah, so cool call to action. Reach out to Michael if you're interested in talking about tokenomics. This was actually part of the originally part of the Game of Realms challenges, right?
Yeah, governance, kind of creating the governance module as a whole was. We largely knocked that out at this point, but what still exists as a Game of Realm competition, which in addition to me revamping some of the elements just to make the submission process smoother for anyone that does want to contribute, so that, you know, there's a bit more of a standardized submission process, a bit more of a standardized timeline on how long until you get feedback from your submission. Just hopefully making that whole thing quicker and easier to use. So in, while the actual governance module itself is kind of largely designed now, at least on a higher level with just the nitpicks left to do, the actual implementation of it isn't, in a sense, where we could still use a proposal system. We have a doc that I'll be posting on the Game of Realms GitHub that goes over the, at least in terms of governance, the exact tasks that someone could theoretically in the community pick up right now to begin receiving either placing on the scoreboard, which will eventually lead to Atom rewards and potentially even a tier level in mainnet Gnoland once we launch, and depending on where everyone ends in the competition. But we'll essentially be putting out tasks of, this is what we have, this is what we need to build with it, and defining that more precisely. And in that case, I have a pretty good overview of all the different types of proposals we'll have. Within those proposals, what are the different aspects or parameters, the different things we'll need to consider. And then from there, hopefully allowing someone in the community or a Game of Realms participant to come in and help with that actual building it, to receive credit for that. So there's going to be a handful of other tasks as well. That's just the one that I've been working on most recently, at least getting out and getting clear for anyone who would be interested. It's actually building the back end essentially of the realm of the proposal system itself.
Yeah. I mean, so one of my questions actually was like, what kind of contributions do you think would be particularly valuable to the project's future? And it sounds like you're kind of building that out. But is there anything else that you could think of that you kind of want to touch on while we're here?
Yeah, I guess just in terms of, so while Game of Realms will be more predefined tasks that are kind of either auxiliary or on the way to a mainnet launch, or at least a full-featured mainnet launch, even if some of those features come slightly after the launch or the airdrop itself. In that case, people will be able to kind of pick and choose more exact ones, or at least that's what we're working on, is predefining a lot more of those competition tasks that will be rewarded in Atom. But in terms of mainnet Gnoland, that'll be a lot more open to what people feel like is needed. We will have our kind of high level objectives. We'll have kind of the core philosophy of the project, which is a lot of what I've already discussed. And from there, someone could say, hey, like, there's no YouTube video on this yet. And they go and they knock out a YouTube video, and boom, they just contributed. They would share that link on the GitHub to that YouTube, and we'd be able to credit it. However, we end up doing that there, which I'm happy to go into more detail some other time on the systems that we currently have built and are testing and considering. It could be more specific code things. It could be things that are in the area of grants for us now, where currently a lot of the applications like DEXs, et cetera, that our dev team just doesn't have the time to knock out in addition to everything else, is handled by grantees. In the future, a lot of that couldn't just be handled by people that are creating their own dApp for the sake of their own company or monetization, but also for people that want to receive contribution effort for doing that. So it'll kind of, again, we envision people of all skill sets to be able to contribute after mainnet, and for that to count based off of the effort opposed to the task itself, and the help that it provides to the overall ecosystem. But more immediately, if you feel like there's any major aspect that you feel like we're lacking, of course, feel free to either submit it as a to me or on the GitHub. If you want to tag me, I'm at Michael Frazzy, F-R-Z-Z-Y, one word. Hey, it would be really cool if someone was building this and I don't see it. And then we can help you determine, does that fit really well in Game of Realms? Does that fit really well as a separate grant? Is that something we want to wait till mainnet and then do it through the GovDAO system? That's kind of the beauty of it, in a sense, where it'll be more of a full-fledged project or full-fledged effort that is then decentralized from there, opposed to something like a more traditional bounty program, at least post Game of Realms competition.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, there's probably a couple of people that this sort of call to action might appeal to, but for those that feel like, you know, kind of just like went over their head, what kind of, you know, like you've been here for a bit, right? Like you kind of have some insight, you've worked with the engineering team pretty closely. I guess like what kind of things would you recommend for someone that's interested in working on NoLand, but doesn't feel like they have the technical how? Like how, you know, what are good first steps? Like how do you get into this without understanding the full picture?
Yeah. Good steps there. And in general, this is even similar to how my kind of step into the blockchain industry started in a sense too, but even just contributing to discussions. You know, you don't, even if it's not very specific code stuff or whatever, there's plenty of issues on GitHub or plenty of discussions or even potentially on Discord, you know, helping us talk through different systems or helping us, you know, kind of understand the priorities of the community at any given time. At least in previous projects, I've always kind of loved that as a barometer in the sense of, hey, you guys, it would be really cool if you had this very specific thing and I've seen nobody mention it. Well, if, you know, I'd love to provide, make it easy for those suggestions to be given so that they could be then considered through one of a multitude of systems here. So even in that sense of, hey, this would be cool, or have you guys considered this? And, you know, if we have, you know, there might be a reason we haven't, or we might have and shot it down, but it doesn't hurt to check. Or a lot of other existing discussions that are already on GitHub, already on Discord, just chiming in and getting familiar with everyone. And if you're not familiar with this 360 of the project, I feel like at this point, it doesn't necessarily, to at least understand the most of the picture of it, doesn't even necessarily require a really heavy programming background, besides you just knowing that we will have our own programming language specifically for blockchain as part of this process. But yeah, just different DAO systems. There's going to be a number of different DAOs on launch, contributing to maybe how the economics or incentive systems of that could work. And since there's plenty that we've already defined, there's going to be some in the future that we have not. Just floating around and seeing whatever is of interest to you and saying hi and saying, hey, that sounds cool, but have you thought about this? Or, hey, I have a concern about that and this is why. As well as things that are more, and then, you know, maybe you do come to understand it. You're able to help us in terms of educating the community. That could be through the comments. That could be through something more formal, like a video or an article. And that's the thing. We're really trying to boil it down. So while Game of Realms will again be a little more defined in the task structure, GnoLand will reward people for covering the full kind of breadth of what would typically require a company to do, in a sense. You know, I mean, DAOs are decentralized organizations, but very few DAOs are able to, in a similar sense, have decentralized marketing or decentralized, you know, different departments that would typically be part of a core company. So we do have that in mind, and it's a big priority to allow people that have something to contribute that aren't necessarily programmers to be able to contribute that. And that's going to be first and foremost. And that's something I think even Jay brings up almost every time that it's mentioned, that's an extremely important aspect of it.
Yeah. You know, I mean, it's actually funny. Internally, we do talk about that quite a bit, but I don't know if externally people are aware that the future of NoLand is heavily dependent on multiple DAOs that are going to function sort of like in their own autonomous, like little sectors of whatever it is that requires for NoLand to move forward.
Right. And I feel like that's any good project. I mean, some of the best ideas I've ever seen over the years were amazing. They just didn't have the marketing, or they didn't understand one particular aspect or some support function or whatever, at least not until later. You know, I'm sure plenty of them figured it out. Plenty didn't. But in that aspect, we're able to kind of allow the community to either bring attention to anything that they want to see or to contribute to anything that is already in progress. And I think while initially, as we're working towards kind of feature completion, it will overall be more programming dependent in a sense. And it would be ideal if that was largely in Go. since our language is very, very similar, largely the same, with different functions. And, you know, I say largely the same. I'm still learning the full differences between Go and Gno after coming on here myself. So that's definitely part of the process. But even other things as well. I mean, there's front-end development stuff that can be done. There's graphic design that could be done in certain instances. I mean, we have this all internally, but I'm sure no one's going to complain if they get a little bit of help. And ultimately, we want to make sure that all of those people are, you know, thanked for their effort there, and they're actually that's acknowledged.
Yeah, I mean, there's also the possibility of like leveraging Noland to develop your own smart contract. So like, the sooner you learn Go and start, you know, reading the docs and getting up to speed, like the sooner that you're going to be able to crank that out once this thing is live.
Well, and that's the thing too. Like, even coming on, I didn't even, you know, like Golang was the last language I ever thought I'd learn. You know, like, I came here very much like a quant geek, like data science kind of Python SQL kind of R ballpark, you know. And as I've learned Go to then learn Gno, which now we have resources that are going to make it easier to just hop straight to Gno without the kind of middle step. Granted, that's the other benefit, though, on a side note, is it's cool that like Go as a language already has so much educational stuff that largely translates one-to-one to what our language will be. So if there ever is anything that is difficult to learn from our documentation, it can largely be picked up there. And then instead of explaining the whole system, you're just explaining the differences there. But now that I kind of have gotten a familiarity with it and, you know, working on porting over like the math RAND package and things that are kind of a little bit more in my realm. I guess that was a pun I didn't mean to be, but like, I feel like I'm like, well, just in general, I mean, and this was part of what I was originally told when I came on, there are a lot of just objective benefits to this versus a lot of other smart contract languages, at least that I've used in the past. The fact that when everything is feature complete, you'll be able to run applications in parallel. You know, there's going to be concurrency in terms of running certain types of functions and certain types of different types of applications and, you know, aspect of things that help with memory and storage management, things that keep things more efficient, things that make data structures way easier to work with, not to mention the fact that we've even been able to bring on people that are like master Go programmers that have never worked on blockchain in their life. And they're able to transition onboard over to working on this project with minimal downtime. I mean, in comparison to a situation where you would be teaching a new language from the ground up, it's like a fraction as much time. Yeah, you got to explain the basics of whatever systems or whatever, perhaps, but a lot of people at this point have at least a cursory understanding of this industry, and they're technical, like, people already, you know, so
weeks of onboarding instead of months.
Exactly. And that's such a major benefit that I've already noticed with this, and just in educating myself on this language as I try to match the kind of the just next level skill of the actual dedicated programmers in comparison to me and my niches here. It's just the more features it get complete, and it's really being built to be as frictionless as possible, not just for the people that are coming from Web 2, but also for people that are used to building smart contracts in other languages, where we've just had to do things certain ways because that's how it works, or because something would break if we didn't do it that way. In this case, we're trying to sidestep a lot of that, and we're trying to make it so that not only can people build more, you know, maybe some more novel designs we haven't seen in the past, but even things like full social media networks. Maybe it's a subscription-based model for some of these dApps where they don't have to pay normal gas fees when you're using that specific dApp. Like, I wouldn't want to pay gas every time I post it on Twitter, you know? So it's like there's a lot of, and, you know, this is part from the language, part from other stuff, of course, but just, yeah, trying to remove that friction, trying to make it so that everything that we wish we would have had in the past when building, at least within, you know, realm of reality and the amount of time that we're looking at here until we're hopefully good to go, making as many of those positive changes as possible, and auto Merkleization and a bunch of other stuff. You can hear Jay and Manfred, some of their talks on YouTube, talk about a lot more extensively than I can here. So that's the thing. It's not just building for the sake of building. It's building with a very specific purpose and a very specific problem that we're trying to solve.
Yeah. Awesome, Michael. Really appreciate all the insight. Like, this has been awesome. I really hope the community like gets excited, you know, checking this video out, seeing some of this stuff. Kind of like, we're kind of approaching the hour mark. And I was kind of, you know, thinking I have quite a few more questions here, but maybe I'll just shift sort of to like an outro kind of situation here. I kind of wanted to ask you, like, what are you enjoying the most about contributing to Know?
I do like the really wide range of different tasks that I'm able to bounce between. You know, one day it could be more traditional quantitative stuff in terms of building simulations or whatever, where the next day it could be working on a new gas or fee system or helping benchmark or more theoretical kind of research design stuff on a higher level. I also love just like, I really do feel like this is like the most aligned I've seen a team. Where everybody shares very similar goals in terms of actually realizing a lot of these promises of the blockchain industry that we've been promised, that we've already seen in a lot of cases, don't get me wrong, but a lot of people share a lot of the same values in terms of transparency, at least in terms of content, open source transparency, and in terms of community governance and things of that nature. Which, you know, you would think is a given working in this industry, but I can tell you firsthand, just because someone works in this industry doesn't necessarily mean that they abide by that stuff. So I love that as well. The grantees, I mean, Birdie, Jeff, who I believe you've talked to before, is, you know, a genius. A lot of these people that we've brought on, I've been able to pick their brains and pick up all kinds of cool stuff from them, and it extends from the core team to the grantees, and then hopefully even to then the Game of Realms contributors, and then the GovDAO contributor tier members, and just kind of keep building it from there. So I love the concept, always have, of kind of starting from scratch and building from the ground up. And no, it's not quite from scratch by the time I came in, but at least for me, it kind of was. We were able to kind of treat some of the different systems that way. And I'm excited to kind of rush for the door and show you guys why it has taken as long as it has. And especially now that I feel like we have a very good grasp on everything, and showing you guys that, yeah, like the airdrop's taking forever, but that's because we're building dozens of cool things to show you guys when that airdrop does happen, as opposed to just, here's a token that's maybe, you know, one or two novel things. We're trying to give you a whole novel ecosystem around that that's directly tailored to things that we wish that we would have seen or wish that we would have had access to in other languages or other VMs, or at least just in terms of governance as a whole, and making sure that the people that care the most are the people that have the most voting power, and that there's systems in place to essentially verify that and to keep tabs on everything and et cetera. So I love the 360 nature of it, and that everything is interconnected, and being able to talk to all the different teams as everyone's working on different aspects, and now just getting that all wrapped up as coordinated as possible, and one aspect at a time is, you know, and that's the other great thing, as the language in VM is a good spot, then those developers can then go and help with the next aspect, and it's kind of this knock-on domino effect of, this part gets done, so these people get freed up to help with these people, and then this project gets done, and these people get freed up to help with this people, and now it's kind of that way all the way to the eventual when airdrop that,
yeah,
I promise, to the when airdrop, as quickly as we can. So
we're getting there. So
bit by bit.
I guess in closing, what are you personally looking forward to the most with Knowland? And I guess, like, once, you know, like, probably one of your biggest goals is like, let's make this airdrop happen. Let's make the tokenomics like smooth. But what do you think you'll do after?
Hopefully help as the ecosystem expands. I mean, I'm already a number of projects that are already going to be built on top of GnomeLand by other teams, other tokens, DEXs, things of that nature, already assisting them in their tokenomics, in their sustainability, risk management aspects, overall designs, things of that nature. I'd love to just continue contributing to the overall growth of the ecosystem as a whole. And you know, basically being able, once the core of this is done, doing whatever I can for all the related projects as well. And I'm sure that a lot of our other teammates are going to do that. I mean, I know that, you know, our engineers are great. Our whole, you know, everyone I've worked with has been, you guys have been. So at this point, I think that's probably going to be the best way forward.
Cool. Well, man, it's been fun hanging out. Thanks for your time, Michael.
Yeah, no, definitely. Really? Always happy to do this in the future here. And maybe I'll be talking a little bit more about this in the near future, maybe hyper focusing on more specific aspects based on what's most interesting to people that see this. So happy to be here.
I'd love to get you back on when this is like concrete, you know, like once definitely. There's no, because I mean, just, you know, you said it a couple times, but like, this isn't final. Everything's going back. There's still like conversation happening. You know, Jay has input, other team members have input, and a lot of this stuff is changing, like sometimes on a weekly basis. You know, good ideas come, bad ideas leave. It's kind of an evolving process, but yeah. So, I mean, in a couple months, like hopefully we'll get you on here and we can actually talk like concrete and like talk about, you know, what changed and what didn't.
That sounds perfect.
Sweet, man. Thanks so much. Looking forward to the next time, and I guess I'll catch you on Slack, and thanks for everyone watching this.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I'll talk to you soon. Thanks again.
Cool. Ciao.
See ya.